And then how do we take all the experimental metadata design and assay values and get them into a coherent data structure? But of course, science kind of applies to me at some point because we're always encountering new problems. And so at the same time, we can't have our data structures be completely rigid. And so we have to then allow some level of flexibility at the user level to be able to assign arbitrary metadata values, since that's part of our design. We also encapsulate our data structures, and that's the big part of this, is encapsulate them behind an abstraction. And software engineering textbook will tell you the advantages of this, but more or less it allows our packages to communicate with each other in a way that where they don't have to know about what's going on behind the scenes, the implementation of their package. So we reduce coupling, and it makes it easier on the developers to maintain, to extend, and especially easier on the users, and because they don't need to worry about, oh, is this package is going to work with this other package, and things tend to speak the same language. So that's how we become interoperable. And so if you compare this to sort of these shell-based pipelines that are commonly employed, where there is a command line program that is executed on a file and then perhaps pipes data into another program and eventually writes something out to the file system again. You can see that in R, in BioConnector, our data are stored mostly as, and we'll work with them as objects in the workspace. And we pass data between modules as objects. Whereas in the shell, there are files and pipes. You see a family line on the shell in the file system. For communication. The other main difference is organization. In R, we have these packages that allow us to sort of systematically organize all of our work, whereas in the shell, there are directories are there for organization. That's a fairly low-level mechanism. It's not always, it's not done in any kind of consistent way, usually. So what are the real differences? I mean, so we, if you're relying on the pipes, for example, well, they'll definitely minimize memory usage because you're streaming data through memory, and so it's fairly efficient. But there is a lot of I/O overhead to using the file system, and a definite loss of abstraction when you're relying on data being encoded as in a particular format, and so there's that. And then there's also that the R packages are clearly advantageous in that they have. It provides sort of a systematic way of encapsulating all of your data, code, and documentation in one distribution. But buying into sort of a BioConnector-like object-oriented framework, of course, is an investment. So it's kind of a high activation energy is trade-off here. But once you make the initial investment, it can be pretty rewarding. But one of the main issues that people encounter working with R is scalability. It is not always the easiest to get to scale properly from working with big data. And so, but our abstractions allow us to implement things in efficient ways that doesn't quite burden the user with the complexity. So our goals in recently have been trying to increase the scalability of our software and really to enable the users to be able to fit things into memory conveniently, and to be able to capitalize on distributed computing resources, and without them having to worry about the underlying complexity. So that if you're looking at scaling software with larger data, there's a few basic strategies that usually come into play, and this list probably isn't complete, but these are the ones we've been focusing on. So if you're looking to represent data in an efficient way, or trying to make it so that we can actually compute on the data, restriction is a big one because it allows you to say, look, I only care about this part of the data, or I only need a random sample of this size to really come to some meaningful conclusion, so I'm just going to read that part of the memory. Or another technique is compression, which just means we're going to represent the same information with less and a smaller size. But then a separate set of strategies is processing. So when processing data, so this is the restriction and the type of compression that's ROMIC encoding, if you're familiar with that, we have six zeros represented by two numbers, the same zero and six when the ROM length. If there's three ones, you have one and three, et cetera. But then processing means, okay, now we need to be able to iterate on the data. And so iteration it's really just taking these slices in some kind of succession and processing them so you can process the entire data set. And that's something that is not typically done in R and something that we can try to make easier. And then doing that iteration in parallel to be able to work on multiple slices at the same time is obviously useful. And then there's this concept of sort of when you're working interactively with the software, the idea of lazy or maybe the cool case called reactive these days, computing, where you can process slices on demand and perform all the computations on demand. Okay. So I'm going to take kind of through an example of showing off these different techniques in sort of dairy calling and how that workflow would work with BioConnector. The background. So the data set that we're going to work with is from the GATK project. They have this, and they published the piece that would all publish this 64X whole genome sequencing of this European HapMap cell line, and the daughter in the trio. And then and they call genotypes on this with their best practices. And so we've just taken this sort of thinking resource bundle, and they make the alignments available for chromosome 20. So we can take that, and it's still big enough, even though it's just one chromosome, it's still more than big enough to be big enough to demonstrate need these techniques if you're doing it on a laptop. And so the better workflow here is pretty simple. So we can do a few steps. We're just gonna do a little basic QA, we're going to compute the coverage. There's some reason to believe that if you have high outline coverage regions in your data, that there are probably some alignment anomalies going on, so you want to be able to take those into account. A lot of times you might expect those to be coincident with say, simple repeats, satellite repeats. So we'll filter those out from the BAM, and then we'll compute some pileups from the filtered BAM, and then visualize the variant calls from GATK with those pileups. And it's really just to show off that you think in a scalable way. So the first sort of technique that we're going to bring up is restriction. And so we're going to do this with multimeric QA. So we have a short read package that will perform various types of QA on short read data. And it has a class called FastQSampler. And the FastQSampler is going to just pull out a random sample of reads from a FastQ file. And so you tell it when you construct it, look at the R code, but when you construct the FASTQ file, you give it the number of reads that this FASTQ sampler, you give it the number of reads that you want to sample each time, and then just the seed, so it's reproducible, and then we'll do a yield, call this yield function on the sampler to get your first 1 million reads. And so it's a simple way to just pull out a subset of the data. So then we'll compute this. Just as an example of a statistic you might generate, these 1 million reads, you might just say, I want to know what are the proportions of base calls, just to make sure there's not some weird anomaly here where one base is being called much more than we expect. And so you can do the second thing. This is just kind of show how we can perform that restriction and get a meaningful result of that without having all the data in memory at once. Okay, so the second example would be compression. So compression comes up when we calculate the coverage. So we're just trying to look for how many reads overlap each position in on chromosome 20. And so we just call the coverage function on the BAM file. What this does is it knows the limits get the coverage. So when it reads in the BAM file, it only reads in the information necessary to compute the coverage. It doesn't read in, say, the quality information or the sequence information. So that's an example of restriction again, kind of behind the scenes. But then the coverage object itself that comes back is interesting. That's a run-length encoded vector. And so the interesting thing here is not run-length encoding, which is commonly done. As you can see, say we have a bond of 59,990 zeros that we encode with just two numbers and save space. But this object acts like an ordinary R vector in memory. So for those who are familiar with those, it's something that we can use, and the user doesn't have to be aware of the fact that it is run length compress.
So how long would it take you to do that on the computer that you use?
not say no more than a minute. There's nothing fancy about the coverage.
For that one chromosome, for the chromosome,
yeah,
that small
yeah,
chromosome.
Yeah, so my, just my laptop, not doing any kind of perils. Let me just, That's, it's, I don't know, it's several tens of millions of reads, maybe like 50 million reads or something, but it's, it takes a little while. There's nothing really fancy about the algorithm or anything. It just, the reads are already sort of ordered in a band file, it just goes through and counts up the coverage. Okay. All right, so the one thing you might have noticed here actually is that our compression is not very good. Because over the whole genome data, there's too much complexity, and so we don't have anything to say that. So we have a 63 million length vector that is compressed into 38 million runs, and each run has two values. So it's actually using more memory than with a testable vector. But in other cases, say in this case, where you now want to find which regions are above some coverage cutoff, we basically would reduce this vector to a logical one, saying true if you're above the cutoff or false if you're not. Now there's obviously a whole lot more compression. So here we can look at the ratio. Now we're paying about 4,000x, 5,000x compression ratio. So it's very efficient. And you might notice, though, that these operations are just like what we would do with any R vector. So it doesn't look like it's anything special, but it is compressed. And the result comes back as a compressed ROV. And then we can do these types of calculations on it. All right, so now a lot of these operations actually not only does the RLE take up less space, but the operation itself becomes faster as you're operating over less data. So the for example here, if we wanted to calculate the sum of the other regions in this high coverage vector, so we just wanted to count up how many positions basically are in these regions. It's kind of so we can compute, but we could just compare it to the normal R vector case. We take our high cub RLE object, we convert it to a normal R vector, high cub vector, and then we just do this micro benchmark thing here that says, you know, if you calculate the sum on the RLE, it only takes 140 seconds. So this is summing up all the values of the RLE. Or if you do it on the entire vector, the 60 million element vector, it takes 82, these are, I think, milliseconds or something, but anyway, it's, you know, several thousand times faster than, orders of magnitude faster than it would be otherwise.
That's awesome. But also, I mean, it only took you, like, order of magnitude 60 seconds to read this in the first place, so it means that the R, sum algorithm is not being very optimal. If they just did what you're doing plus whatever, if they did what you're doing, they could speed things up for any kind
of they would have to run that compressor,
right?
Which takes a little while for something like this, but you're right. A lot of it comes down to the memory allocations they have to make. Because they have to allocate such big blocks of memory, that can take a long time. So we want to summarize now these regions. Let's say, so instead of just summing up the entire vector, we want to sum up each individual, so we've got these high coverage windows on the coverage, right? And we want to sum up each of these high coverage windows to sum up total coverage in those windows. It's kind of an artificial thing, but just to show this off, what we can do is take the, take our coverage object of chromosome 20 and slice it by our coverage cutoff of 120. And we end up with this views object. And the views object, rather than splitting up this object into millions of pieces and having to allocate millions of little R vectors everywhere, it'll take a long time to just allocate. We're able to just kind of layer on these windows on top of the underlying coverage vector without any kind of undue memory copying or construction of objects. And so this is kind of a different kind of compression where we're now sort of virtually partitioning the data without having to actually create those objects. And this ROE views object acts a lot like these other ranges objects. It has these ranges defined, these partitioning ranges defined on it when the coverage is high. And it just acts like another ranges object, so it's all abstracted. And so now we also can implement fast operations on these view objects because we have this formal structure, we know what it looks like, and we can now have this code that we write in C that just goes over these and say calculates the means of all these views. And this happens very fast because this is all native code. So here is kind of another example of restriction where we want to query the UCSC genome browser for all the repeat regions on chromosome 20. And we want to say, and we're only interested in the simple repeats and low complexity repeats. So it's kind of a lot of code, but basically it just establishes that we wanted to bring in chromosome 20. We get the table from the browser session, and we subset it down to the simple repeats. And then we build up this object called G-ranges. The G-ranges is just a way to represent these ranges, these repeat ranges, in a formal way. And so the G ranges is basically just a table of the seq names in the chromosome it's on, the ranges on the chromosome, strand, and then it has, those are the fixed columns, and then it has arbitrary metadata columns that we can use for any kind of data we're dealing with at the moment. So in this case, we're dealing with repeats, so the user just stuck on a factor column called repeat class. Simple. And so this is really kind of trying to find a balance between maintaining the integrity of the data, the most important pieces, that is the fact that these are ranges, while allowing just arbitrary metadata to be attached by the user. And so it's sort of a pragmatic compromise. Okay, so now we kind of move from sort of ways to represent data efficiently to ways to process data using those types of representations. So here, we're going to talk about iteration. So, and normally in R, when you iterate over data, you simply load all the data in memory as these big R vectors, and then you perform vector operations on them to compute, and all these computations happen in native code, and are pretty fast and efficient, actually, once you have it in memory. But this actually makes it really easy to run out of memory, especially the way that R manages this memory. And that can actually cause both space problems and time problems. But you can't just say, okay, I'm just going to read in one value at a time, because nothing in R is optimized for that. It's optimized for dealing with vectors. And so there's a lot of overhead dealing with single element vectors, which you'd be dealing with. So as a compromise, you need to iterate over subsets. So you bring a subset of data in, say just whatever chunk that you can, chunk size that you can fit into memory. You process that, and then you move on to the next chunk. And so in genomics, you know, there's various ways that we can imagine doing this, sort of geometries of how we would iterate. So you might think of, say, I just want to simply stream element at a time over a band file. Okay, that would be, there'd be a lot of overhead for that. Do that. Or you can do chunking, which is so many numbers of elements at a time. Or you can tile. So you can tile the genome and say, I'm going to compute this region of the genome, all the reads in this region of the genome, separate for every 1,000 kb window. Or you can do a conditioning on a factor, for example, and something like that, where you summarize, say, all the repeats that are in low complexity and then all the repeats that are in the satellites or similar. So then, there's various ways, you know, that you can go over this. You can go over by samples. So you can say, I'm gonna do one sample at a time. I'm gonna deal with chunks of reads. And so these are just the diagram representations. And then, so as an example, how you might screen over a band file. This code here, the crux of this code is right here, where we just open up this band file, and we have this coverage vector that's been zero initialized. And then we just loop while this stream is incomplete. We read in the alignments, and then we add the coverage of those alignments onto the current coverage, and we just loop and eventually we close the stream. And so with each iteration of the while loop, we read in alignments and we add them up. It's a fairly simple algorithm. And this is how you would do it, yielding chunk at a time coverage calculation. One of the things we want to do is try to make this easier for people so they don't actually have to write out this algorithm every time that they want to do a sort of incremental coverage calculation. That's something we're still trying to figure out how to deal with. And then the other way you can do it is over the partitions. So you can generate a set of tiles in the genome, it's a tile genome function. On chromosome 20, you say I want a billion omega tiles to be 1 billion width, so 1 megabase pair at a time. And now I just loop over my tiles. I do the same thing that I did before, basically, calculate coverage on things, and then reduce them by adding up all those vectors that I get for all the tiles. So now, another thing we can do with these iteration is filtering a band file. So there's a high level function called filter band that will filter a band file for us as long as we can define a rule that's applied to some chunk of the data. So what we do first is we will first index our repeats, our key ranges of repeats, into a repeat tree. And this G interval tree is an interval tree, so it's optimized for overlap detection. And the abstraction here is that the repeat tree acts just like a set of ranges, just as it was before. So we can treat repeats tree just as another ranges object in R. But behind the scenes, though, it's been indexed for fast overlap computation. So the user doesn't have to really worry about this, but behind the scenes, it's faster. And then we'll define our rule to filter out all the, what we want to do is filter out all the reads that overlap a repeat. So we simply get the reads, and then we check to see, okay, if the reads are outside of the repeats, then we'll allow them through. That's all this does. And then we pass that rule to the filter band function here, and the band file will be filtered according to some chunk size.
Trying to figure out what a cigar is here.
Cigar. Right. So what we've done is we've simply defined which parts of the band file we want to read in. So this is kind of an example of restriction where we, in order to calculate the coverage, we don't have to know the sequence that we need or the quality of the read. And the R name is going to be the chromosome name. The pos is going to be the position where the read starts. And the cigar is the it's a well-made encoding, basically, of the alignment structure. So where the gaps are in the alignment, and where how the ends have been masked. It really just tells us the structure of the alignment, the read alignment, the band file. And that's interpreted automatically by this G alignments function and knows how to deal with the cigar and creates basically a range or representation of G. And then we can do these types of overlap operations of the outside operator. Say is this thing inside or outside? These overlap at all. Does that make sense?
The silly acronym. I agree with
it. Yeah. It's
just kind of, yeah.
So now we can extend iteration to parallel computing. So why parallel computing? Well, it's pretty obvious that around the year 2004, the speed of chips to start asymptote. So in terms of either the number of transistors that fit on a core or the clock speed, all started to plateau around 2004. And so they simply started adding more cores so that they can achieve it still matched up with Moore's law. And so really now we're in an age of, as kind of known as kind of small multiple computing, where we just make more cores and more chips, more CPUs, in order to keep our hardware scaling. And so, you know, and with regard to this, you know, we could score, we could scale at multiple levels, either the core, the processor, or just the upper node. And it's not really, important, you know, there are various ways we, reasons why you might choose one or the other. But the key is that we're operating over multiple parts of the data simultaneously. So what are the costs of doing this though? So you can take advantage of more hardware, but it's actually going to make your code a lot more complicated. And you're probably going to announce on your code is now going to start talking about hardware. You're going to start talking about the CPU, you're going to talk about, you know, multiple nodes, sending things between nodes. Whereas, you know, most of all, you know, dealing at high level layers here to try to hide this from the hardware. So we end up having to make our code dependent on hardware, which is kind of unfortunate. And so it's not really, you know, something there, there needs to be something there that can help protect us from that. And there's also, in terms of working interactively, you're now in batch mode processing, it's not always convenient. And so to kind of address this, we come up with this package called the Bowsy Parallel Package. And the goals of this are really just to bring sort of parallelized iteration to BIOSI, and really to abstract away how we're actually going to iterate in parallel, how we're actually going to allocate the resources. And so these are all now, we have these BIOSI parallel param objects that will abstract that away. So we'll have a param object for, say, computing serial, so not no parallel computing. We'll have a parameter object presenting the fact that we want to have that we want to do multiple cores, or we have this batch jobs parameter, and batch jobs is the package in R that abstracts and handles multiple types of clusters, like a central engine or LSF and all these types of things. And there's also some other backends. But these backends, they all provide the same API, so we can treat them all equivalently, and we don't have to worry about making our code depend on any one cluster configuration, or say cores, we're doing it locally or cluster. And so here we're computing nucleotide pileups and parallels. So we've got a list of kind of set up our multi-core parameter here. We just add, you know, on this laptop, I have two cores, so I'm going to get a multi-core parameter of two cores. And now I'm going to use this BPLApply function, which is just like the LApply in R, except it's now parallelized. So when I loop over our tiles over chromosome 20 and complete the pileups for each of those tiles, two iterations are happening simultaneously, one on each core. But where this really kind of becomes cool is that we now have the potential to take these parameter objects and pass them down to low-level infrastructure functions, and they no longer need to worry about, you know, should I have a parameter for a core, should I have a parameter for like which host this should be on? All this is just hidden away, and so now we can write our infrastructure code in a way that's generalized, and we can just pass these parameter objects down the stack, and everything works as the user intended. Okay. And so the pileups actually come back as a V ranges, which is similar to a G ranges, except now we have additional formal fixed columns that we've added, say ref and alt alleles, total depth and stuff like this, that are useful for variant calling. And so in theory, you've designed G-ranges so it's easy to extend it and then stipulate that there are additional fixed columns so that it sort of can be customized. G-ranges can be customized to different workflows. You sort of want to standardize on variant calling or on some type of, say, RNA-seq expression coding. It's all available here. Okay, so finally, I just want to talk a little bit about visualization. So this is kind of a diagram of sort of how one might apply the model view controller paradigm. So where you have your data is your model here, and you've got a view that's displaying the graphics to the user, and then the user is they're functioning as a controller through a controller, is in some way that is changing how the data are being presented. And if you think about your sort of typical genome visualization, we might have coverage that's been pre-computed, that's being displayed over the whole chromosome. Then the user has zoomed down into one particular region of that view. And now we can take the coverage out from this big rig object that's indexed all the coverage. We can take that out dynamically without having to load in all the coverage information. We can just dynamically retrieve that using the indexes in the big rig file. Same thing with transcripts. You have a database of transcripts you retrieve. But we can even do more complicated things, like for the reading alignments, we can pull those out of the BAM file as a slice. But then we can also perform filters and things like that on the sort of dynamically in reaction to the user zooming into this region. So these filters could, for example, filter out the low quality reads or filter out the reads that aren't compatible with the transcript that is currently in view or whatever it is, that's not splicing compatible, let's say. So all these things can happen dynamically, so we don't have to pre-compute them all. That's reactive and response to the user. This is kind of the way that the big data, one very effective strategy for visualizing big data. And so we're kind of working towards that by we developed this package called GGBio, where we now have this is sort of based on the grammar graphics ideas, if people are familiar with ggplot. We have this function called autoplot that will take a bioconductor object, no matter what it is, and try to figure out what is the best way to plot this object at a track, let's say. And then it will, so you call, say, okay, I have a genome object, this is a DS genome object, it has a sequence inside of it, I'll call autoplot on that. But the key is that we can, for each of these things, we can pass this which argument, this region of interest, ROI, that you choose, and this will restrict, you know, so it only retrieves that part of the genome sequence. And the same thing for the tallies, for the VCF, and everything like that. It all comes down and stacked up in this tracks call to yield something like this. So that little bit of code there has managed to for one particular region of the BAM file, has plotted out the genomic sequence at the bottom, the variant calls from the VCF that was published by Jack Kay, and then the nucleotide tallies that we can use. So you have each of these bars corresponds to a mismatch being a base, otherwise just gray for reference. So it looks like, you know, that they're very common reference region. So that's these are the types of things we're developing so that you can, around this, you could construct some kind of system where you could interactively move over the genome in a sort of genome browser-like way, and then compute all these things on the fly, but you have the flexibility of R, and you can define all of your customized visualization in a whole bunch of different ways, compared to, say, a normal standalone genome browser. Right. So in conclusion, to summarize that, we have these complex data, and we're relying on these normal data structures to ensure our data integrity. And these are all abstractions allow us to do two things. They allow us to be interoperable between packages, and they hide a lot of the details that we rely on to be scalable along the complexity. And then I showed how we can apply these various strategies to vary common. So if you're interested in learning more about the bioconductor, there are course materials that are freely available on the BioSync website that cover, you know, these types of packages that I mentioned here. There's also an edX.org course that's being given by Raphael Rosera and Michael Love at Harvard. This is edX.org, is one of these Coursera, you know, free course sites. And this is something that you can start to get paid. There's, I don't know how many tens of thousands of people have already signed up for it, but it's going to be a pretty popular course. You know, it'll go through a lot of these ideas. And also, I just like to mention that in case anyone is not an R user and frustrated by the way that R deals with this memory, we've been making some improvements to that. So in R 3.1, which is coming out next month, I actually actually made a patch to R that will, that brings shallow and lazy duplication of objects to avoid a lot of the deep duplication that goes on now. So I don't know if it uses R for big data, but it quickly will blow out available memory due to the number of copies it makes when modifying objects. And this is all going away with these the changes. So I was amazed they actually accepted my patch, because it makes pretty dramatic changes to the internals of R.
Oops.
they accepted it because, they're cool about it, and because it makes a big difference. And they've also, because I did that, I think, they said, well, you know, we have to contribute something too. So two of the R core people made some real changes as well. They brought Luke Tierney, who's the main sort of memory management wizard in R core, now has implemented real reference counting on objects that you can enable in compile time. And that gives you that now is getting away from the, you can now much more efficiently manage your memory. And then there's Simon Urbanek with the ability to override how R even allocates the memory. So you can, in theory, allocate memory to nmap, and then so have things sort of being dynamically pulled to disk by the operating system and things like that. So these are cool advances. That's all I had.
Plans of using reference classes instead of S4?
Yeah, so reference classes as behave as references, so that the semantic is different. So we toyed with the idea of could we try to use reference classes to avoid copying when we don't want it, and then but still copy explicitly when the user expects it to happen. And this is actually what the set class does in BioBase that we use to represent microarray data, for example, was always presented as these ESETs. Behind the scenes, there's an environment that stores the matrices. So there, they can prevent duplication, needless duplication of those matrices. We just modify something else in the object. But that, first of all, there's no point to that because the matrices are usually not that big. But the other thing is that this is no longer necessary with these changes. With these changes we've made, that there's so much less copying going on. That would be it, probably not worth the trouble. We don't want to change the semantics of how R works as a value, it's value-based. There are definitely cases where it makes sense in terms of what you're working with, that things are reference classes. And we do have a few reference classes in the API, but not in general, it's because it's so different from the rest of it. Yeah.
Yeah, I was glad you brought this up to the point to ask. I usually deal with dense high resolution data, so I deal with vectors at one base pair resolution, and my experience in the past is just trying to load a single chromosome worth of this data, which should just be like a couple of gigabytes worth of memory, and R just like totally blows up. Yeah. So is that. Is this going to?
I think it's that. I think this fixes that.
Okay.
This is something that I wanted to do for a long time, actually. Robert told me that it never worked, so I didn't do it. But I finally decided to do it anyway. It worked. So.
Your face, Robert.
It should be recorded. I don't know.
I'm in YouTube.
Yeah, but Robert's not a fan of Google, so he's not going on YouTube. Don't worry about that.
No, that's on YouTube. So I'm not familiar with working with this kind of data in R, and I'm wondering, is there a set of widgets that lets me translate to and from the various browser track formats into the representations that you went through, and lets me translate back out again? I mean, can I go to the UCSC browser tracks and chunk, not just BigWig, but the other track formats into this?
Well, yeah, our track layer package supports the parsing of GFF and all the major platforms. Directly to the UCSC table in their base and the list that directly out of UCSC.
So is there there at UCSC or anywhere else a resource where you can, as a web service, query for the existence of tracks and grab them via R and or publish tracks that you've generated?
Yeah, that's what our TrackLayer does.
TrackLayer does.
Our TrackLayer. Okay.
So one of the useful things about BioConductor is that you can grab annotations, right, from like UCSC Genome Browser and annotate your variants. When you download those in R, they're usually expressed as like character vectors. So have you thought about how do you manage detection of these annotations?
Annotations, like the repeat annotations or the gene annotations?
Yeah, like gene annotations.
Yeah, if you use our track to download the gene annotations, they'll come down as G-ratings. So you'll be able to use them directly for, say, variant annotation and stuff like that. They also, you can also just get, there are packages that bundle the UCSC annotations, just as an R package with the objects are pre-built. You can just install those. Genomic features packages can be that.
I'm thinking more of like, not like ranges.
Okay.
But like annotations like transcript IDs.
Oh, okay.
Or like.
Yeah, they come down. They come down as character. Yeah,
stuff.
They come down as character vectors usually.
Yeah.
So why is that not working?
That could really increase the size of your objects, right?
Oh yeah.
You guys dealt with like how to manage those kind of.
I mean you're not usually gonna have a problem with the gene annotations. They're not that big, but. Every character, every string in R is essentially an integer, and so they're all hashed. So every element in the character vector, it just takes up the size of one integer. So it's not too bad. So about 4 bytes, right, or 8 bytes if you're on a 64-bit machine, probably. And that's it. They're basically pointers. It's all that's stored. So whatever the pointer size of that machine is, but so you can, they're not too bad in memory, but I guess we haven't really looked into how to compress a character vector to work with it.
Yeah, it's just because I noticed some DCFS would be really big, actually.
Yeah, so that's where it's really important to restrict and make sure you really need what you really need. Yeah.
Okay, so I'd just like to take this opportunity. We've printed out these lovely certificates of participation, which have every bit as much value as you're willing to put into them, in terms of your own personal value system. But we do appreciate that you've both come here to give us these lovely talks, and thank you very much.